to play. Warriors, come out to play. Warriors, come out to play.
In Africa, I had a reason to be born there. So we have God. We have our gods and we have our mode of worship.
Queens, nod your head if you know you got soul. Women, snap your fingers, let your head rap go. Come on. Kings, got us good like we ain't trapped around.
Freedom's what we need, more solutions is the key. Wave the banner of the free, that's the red, black and green. Bringing truth to the streets, war to get no enemy. If it's peace, we at ease, if it's war, we don't cease. EYEs on the crackers and police. Never slack up even when we free, cause we ain't free until we get the land, that's the green. Black power, new African, liberated from the thieves. Nothing better else to be.
Queens, not your head if you know you got soul. Women, snap your fingers, let your head rap roll. Come on, kings, got us good like we ain't rap brown.
Stimulated cause I'm liberated. Rock me Africa, medallion in the middle of the clan. Situation freedom come drum playing by the river. I deliver for my people, it's the sequel of revenge. My friends get ready, every knee shelf bow, every tongue shelf tail. On the mountain I reveal, throw the shells, four lights side up. Dark wine up in my cup, pour it out and then I strut. A lafia,
E-D. Queens, nod your head if you know you got soul. Women, your head rap roll, come on. Kings, got us glitter like we ain't rap brown. All my brothers, put your hand on your chest now.
When Africa doesn't want to understand or participate in the reason why he was born.
Your head, if you know you got soul. Women, snap your fingers, let your head rap roll. Come on. Kings, got us glitter like we ain't rap brown. All my brothers, put your hand on your chest now.
See, Africa has not been able to contribute its own knowledge to this universe. But we have knowledge in Africa. In a sense.
Yeah, of course.
You see, so all these things need to be in the education system of African countries.
Nah, Jelana, that is Olu Ashe. That ain't Rich. That's Olu Ashe. Yeah. Get Ready is the name of the song by Olu Ashe. Yeah. Anyway, man, ETM Hotel Rennie Sean, welcome in peace. My name is Sean. Thank you, everybody, for tapping in. Please like the show, share the show, tell a friend, we're actually live. And for those of you who will catch the replay, appreciate you tapping in. To catch the replay, and hopefully you'll learn something today, as is the initial goal every time that I hit the live button. So before we get started, I do want to talk about something real brief, well, real quickly, in regard to a lot of the information that I have been speaking about lately. If you go back and you look at all the shows, from critical thinking to evolution to COVID to West African history, West Central, Southeast, Northeast African history, and African American history, it's all been to make sure that our people have a library or a wealth of information to refer to one day in case anything stops, in case I stop, in case our brothers stop. This information should outlive us all. And that's the initial goal of the Mossy, and that's the initial goal of Kofi Paisai research team. They're two separate entities, but same tree, different branch. So hopefully, you know, one day this information will be received by the mass of people who are looking to educate themselves on their ancestry and who they descend from and learn more about them, who are intrigued with pre-colonial history and the effects of colonialism and slavery and the effect that it actually had on African-Americans and Africans in the diaspora. And a lot of times we only talk about our struggles here in the Americas, but we really don't get into the experience or the role of slavery in European nations for our brothers and sisters that are in the UK. And that's pretty much tough because we really don't get into it. And more specifically, you know, people that we've lost along the way with their beliefs and how they try to remove themselves from Africa per se. All right, so I appreciate everybody tapping in. I apologize for the ignorant comment that's in the chat right now. Don't really want to give it too much life. There's no way in hell that anybody that you're affiliated with can do anything, which, man, I don't even know why he even took the conversation, but I just wanted to say that. So I'm glad people are here. For those of you that are here and those of you that are actually catching the replay, this one right here is for West Africa. Like I said, I've continued to move forward in my teachings and trying to build around the information. Last week, I went extremely hard, trying to get the right information out there to people to make sure that they're not caught up in the bull jive of people like Buddy currently and things of that nature. However, man, I got a purpose. I don't know what your purpose is, but I got a purpose. And my purpose ain't to deal with that type of energy that people used to out there. So I'm about to share my screen. And we're going to get into this bill. And we're going to turn it up. So I don't know if y'all know anything about the Afikpo people. You don't really hear too much about them in history. I know for a fact that a lot of y'all really probably don't even know who these people are. And you may even be descendants of these people. So there's a lot that we can get into regarding the Afikpo people. But we're not going to go too far into this as we have an amassed amount of people that have attention span problems. And a lot of times that tends to be boring for a lot of people and they're not entertained by the bull jive. And it allows them not to give us their true undivided attention because their attention spans is only broadened for stupidity, in my opinion. So the Afikpo history and culture, I mean, the Afikpo history, art, and culture. That's what this presentation is about. And to the right of you, you can see a particular festival that is transpiring and taking place. And in the background of this particular video, you can't really see it, but that's out there in the courtyards of the village life where this festival is being held along with many others. And if you hadn't paid attention to this particular mask that's on the screen, that's an Afikpo mask as well. It's a dope mask, got the bull's horns on it and all of that. And it's got other resemblances and things that are part of it as far as scarifications. Also, you'll see another particular animal head at the centerpiece of this particular sculpture. So hopefully, you know, if you're on your cell phone or anything else like that, you'll be able to acknowledge what's going on with that. So, just a few things that we're going to talk about today. Of course, I'm going to give you my introduction, hypothesis, narrative, conclusion, sources. To the right, you see a picture, and you're going to continue to see this picture when it shows up, but it's two sisters doing a festival dance, and as you can see, this is a Afikpo, so they wear a multitude of colors. And they all have some resemblance to represent who they are. So you'll see gold, you'll see green, you'll see red, and you'll see white. And those are significant colors among the people, but not only the only colors. So I don't want y'all to think that they're just tied to these specific. No, there's a multitude of colors. So, you know, I see that the fool has been muted. All right, introduction. The history and culture of the Afikpo people are seldom spoke of, let alone mentioned in history. People assume that all West Africans are either culturally connected or similar in some way. Today we examine artistic expression of the Afikpo and its distinctiveness. In order to talk about the art, you got to talk about the history. In order to talk about the history, you got to talk about the culture. They intertwine. So the lack of detailed research and attention paid to West Africa could be contributed to the fact that colonialism and the African Holocaust has created this narrative. However, I'm of the belief that the Afikpo are one of the most unique people of Nigeria, which but also candidates for those who looked to prey on them. It's supposed to be made. Excuse me. He said, oh, they Piru. Nah, they got some blue in them. Now, the Afikpo village is a group located on the west bank of the Cross River. If you're familiar with the Cross River, that's around that area. Well, you ever heard of the Cross River connection where you have Cameroon on one side and Nigeria on the other side? Well, of course, since they're located in Nigeria, they're going to be on the west side. They're going to be on the west bank side of the Cross River. Just where it turns southward is in the east central state of Nigeria, with a population that I estimated to have been around 35,000 persons in 1960. Now, let's carry out research there. And this is the author speaking. It was one of some 200 village groups of the Igbo, each of which had, until recent times, a certain degree of autonomy, for there never was a single Igbo state. That's significant because you have the Igbo right next to the Cross River. A lot of these people were essential in being enslaved and brought to the Americas. I don't really bring that out in this particular presentation, but I'm just trying to show some of y'all that, hey, yeah, maybe a fake poet. Cultural uniformity has not been the rule among the Igbo. For many years, they have been an expanding and an absorbing people, and that the village groups vary greatly in their features and forms of their kinship, political styles, and art. It should be noted at the very onset that I'm not considered a fake peg to be typically Igbo, whatever that means, in cultural and social forms. Rather, they are a blend of Igbo and other cultures to their south and east. The Afikpo belong to an Igbo subgroup called the Eda or Ida, all right, which includes the Akponha, the Eda, Amasiri, and Anwana village groups, all which border on the Afikpo and the Imporo and Akazi, both short distances away. The Eda have many common features in their history and culture. They have past associations with the famous slave trading Igbo of Arochukwu, some 40 miles to the south, and their population includes other immigrant groups from various Igbo areas, as well as a residue of ancient non-Igbo peoples having cross-river cultures. The earliest known peoples is in the Ada area. The Ada are known for the prevalence of double unilateral descent, for well-developed age-grade organizations, for their military and head-taking activities in the past, and for their characteristic forms of art and rituals. These features differentiate them from other Igbo and from the Cross River groups. Now, the Afikpo village group has had a mixed past, quickly discernible if one tries to collect the history of any particular village there. It was probably originally composed of small settlements of a number of matrilineal Cross River people, one of whom today is called the Igbo in the legends. Some several hundred years ago, groups from the Arochukwu and Igbo areas to the west and northwest of the village group, primarily patrilineal in organization, moved in and conquered the area. The region became closely linked to the European slave trade through the hands of the Arochukwu people who came to dominate Afikpo. Europeans, however, did not go there at this time. As far as we know, Afikpo is thus composed of an amalgam of Cross River and Igbo cultures. Today, non-Igbo peoples still live to the east of the Afikpo on the other side of the Cross River. The English, using African troops, fought their way into the village group in 1902, and the area became and still is today an administrative headquarters of educational center for the larger Afikpo division. I'm going to run that back in case y'all lost that. The English, using African troops, fought their way into the village in 1902. So 120 years ago, the English used African troops to fight their way into this village area. Peace led to a loss of much of power for the Aro, to a cession of military activities, and to greatly increased trade contacts of Afikpo with other people. Thus, since the coming of the British, there has been considerable fishing activity by the Afikpo on the Cross River for many miles upstream, downstream to the coast, and a good deal of trade with the coastal city of Calabar in the Afik ethnic area. Now, remember, the Calabari are essential in the slave trade. You have many brothers and sisters among other ethnic groups in Nigeria that despise the Calabari for what their participations was. And even some of them were enslaved. But they're also well known for their screams and their statues that they make that resemble the way that their political structure is set up among them. I just want to slide that in there in case many of y'all have not watched my presentation about the Calabari. Now, the Afikpo have also had increasing contact and trade with other Igbo to the west, southwest, and north. It is not surprising, therefore, that the mass tradition of the Afikpo shows recent Afikpo Ibibio and Nog influences on the one hand, and influences from Igbo areas on the other. The 22 villages of Afikpo are divided into five subgroups by historical and cultural differences too detailed to discuss here. Each of these five has some special masquerade feature that characterizes it. In particular, the northern subgroup of communities, Azaza, somewhat isolated from the rest of the village group, has different customs, shrines, and rites than other Afikpo areas. Now, the author states here, in his own work was carried out primarily in the Itim subgroup, and what he describes here centers on these villages, especially Mbom and Umaro. This subgroup has had direct and obvious contacts with the Ida village group, which borders it, more so than some other sections of Afikpo. Its villages are also the only ones to have certain secret society initiation rituals and a formal priest and assistant priest for each secret society. The subgroup contains agricultural settlements, the Imbongo and the Amaro, fishing villages, the Anahand and the Kipongripo, and a mixed community of Anahand and Kola. The mask rites in the fishing villages differ somewhat from those in the farming ones, which I know best. This dichotomy of farming and fishing with the containment ritual variations occurs elsewhere in the Afikpo. For the farming groups of the Afikpo, yams, ladies and gentlemen, is the principal crop, are grown almost exclusively by men, while females raise cassava, cocoa yam, corn, and many other vegetables. The work is hard, for Afikpo is not a rich farming area with its sandy soil and sandstone ridges. Farming activities, in fact, the whole life of the people depend upon a four-day week. They're farming four straight days. Ori is a farm day, although in the Atim subgroup of the Afikpo, some mask rituals are held at this time during the ceremonial season. The next day, the Aha, is a small marketed day. Some persons farm, but others do not. And Kuo, which follows, is also a farm day. This is followed by Iki, the major Afikpo market day, when no farm work is done and many persons visit the central market to buy and sell. So basically what I just did was run down to y'all who may be paying attention the days of the week among the Afikpo, which is the 4 days. So you have Ori, O-R-I-E, Aha, A-H-A, Nkwo, N-K-W-O, and last but not least, I think I might have skipped one here, the Ike, E-K-E, yeah. Now, it is the major time at the Afikpo Forest for feast, ceremonies of all kinds, and mask rites. The traditional month of 28 days is composed of 7 4-day weeks. So I'm reiterating the point that was just made. 28 days, 4-day week. 7 4-day weeks, 28 days. Now, the Afikpo weekly and monthly cycle forms the basic time sequence for the presentation of the mask rites. Before the Afikpo week has now become integrated to some extent with the European one, so that the very best day for ceremonies in either context is an Ike day that falls on the European quote-unquote Sunday. So they still keep their 4 days, but you know, because of colonialism, and everybody knows that missionaries go in and do some of the things, they didn't eliminate these people's 4-day week. But what they did was made one of the influences was to make the Ike, the 4th day, a holy day, per se. The village group is permeated with relationships of descent, both patrilineal and matrilineal. Everyone is a member of both types of organizations. The patrilineal ones are organized on a residential basis associated with ancestral shrines and other shrines concerned with the human and crop fertility. These agnatic groupings are the basic political units through which the village administration is organized. The members of the matrilineal grouping are widely dispersed within the Afikpo. Each matrilineal clan has a central shrine at the compound of its priest. The usual meeting place of the descent group, the Utarian groups, are the primary land-holding organizations, and this interest provides the major basis for their unity. The Afikpo village is the focus of the mask rites. This settlement joining together persons of different patrilineal and matrilineal groupings is the basis of much of the political life of the Afikpo. In addition, each village has its own secret society with which the masks are directly associated and through which the mask rites occur. So, during these secret, I mean, within these secret societies, during these specific locations, these masks and these ritual practices and things of that nature are held in secrecy per se. The village vary greatly in size, being composed of large groups, medium groups, and smaller groups. Each village composed of numerous compounds made of patrilineal groups. The medium and larger groups are grouped into wards, and each ward has its own men's rest house. In the rest house, the elders meet. They meet there. Also keep all ritual and mask equipment stored there. The rest house is also where the elders assemble. Assemble among each other, which contains a senior ward of the village. And this ward is where those mask rituals are held, as I stated before. The Afikpo village, unlike many other Igbo communities, is compact and clearly delineated. Now, it has a well-developed system of age grouping for both men and women, authority and activity being largely determined by one's age relative to that of another person. The village is led by its elders, as are its wards and compounds, but there is no real village chief. Rather, some elders, usually from the older compounds of the settlement, are more influential than others. It is largely the elders acting as a group of who rule the village and, likewise, their own particular compounds. Each village also has a secret society, although it is not really very secret. For it lacks an exclusive character, all males are expected to join it by the time that they are adults, and many become members as children. It thus excludes females and uninitiated boys. The secrecy involves much of the initiation rites, certain titles taken within it, and some other events. The masquerades, which form one of its principal activities, are generally held in public, although there are secrets associated with them. There's a good deal of variation in the organization and the activities of the village secret societies at Afikpo. As we have seen, the Atim villages have very special ritual leaders lacking in other Afikpo secret societies. The forms of initiation also differ considerably among the villages, as do some of the mask rites. These reflect the complex and particular histories of different communities, but every secret society is led by two groups. The holders of certain senior titles in the society and the voluntarily ritual group, which directs many of society's rituals and controls its spirit shrine. The cooperative activities of these two groups of influential persons form the leadership of the society. Now, the secret organization draws males apart from females by exclusion, and it is said by Afikpo to be the main agency to keep women in their place. Females often fear it, its power and its spirit, and if one violates its regulations or sees activities that women are forbidden to witness, it is believed that she is defiled and will no longer become pregnant. To atone for her error, she must make a purifying sacrifice at the spirit shrine. The dichotomy between the sexes in their lifestyle and activities is a great at Afikpo, and the secret society reinforces it. No women wear masks or directly take part in the society's activities. The thought of such action would be considered ridiculous by males. The sense of sexual distinctiveness is strong at Afikpo, and the men as a whole prefer to keep it that way. So here are some highlights of the Afikpo. Their local language, which is Okwu, Ehubo, is a dialect of Igbo, which is the common language among the five southeastern states of Nigeria, Abia and Anambra, Ebonyi, Enugu, and Imo states. However, most people in Afikpo are fluent in English, or the pidgin version called broken English. Yeah, so they do a little bit of code switching as well, Chavis, among the Afikpo. Now, several archaeological findings support the claim that Afikpo civilization existed as far back as the Neolithic Age. Afikpo is also home to some of Africa's top traditional dance groups, artists, and cultural festivals. Afikpo is the mecca of ancient Igbo tradition and ceremonial, now antique, masks, which have been carefully preserved. Some of these masks are on display in museums and for sale in art galleries worldwide. Afikpo people are mainly traders, farmers, and civil servants. The town used to be predominantly agrarian community, with farmers making up the bulk of the population. But that is changing as an increased number of civil servants and traders call Afikpo home. Now, a charming and sensitively carved mask depicting a woman from the Afikpo subgroup of the Igbo people of Nigeria. As is typical of Afikpo masks, this one is attached to a woven basketry collar, which has become soft through handling, indicating that the mask likely saw a good amount of work or a good amount of use of work, as you can see. Now, this mask is the Igbo Afikpo mask, where they call it the Mimaji, which is the yam root knife. Mimaji called mask, the bow-like forehead extension represents a machete that was used in the field work and used to be a weapon. Also, this mask is worn during the masquerade of what you all should know or have grown accustomed to when it comes to Nigerians or any West Africans, the yam festivals. You'll see this mask a lot during those festivals. Now, the Afikpo Mimaji, or the yam knife, as you can see, we just saw the last mask, but here we have some other examples of that mask, are commonly used in the Okonkwo performances in Afikpo, which is Eastern Igbo land. And this pictures from the 1950s. And if you look really closely in your background, I don't know if you can see my cursor or not. You should be able to see that little blue dot going around. Real, now I'm gonna slow it down. These are children that are watching the festivities. Now, wrestling in Afikpo, this is good right here, is a major form of relaxation. It has a season and is greatly celebrated all through Afikpo. It gets the interest of everybody, men and women, young and old. It is one part of the Afikpo culture that modern world has not taken away. They have not taken away. People from all walks of life come together to watch it. People leave their businesses or close their shops to be at the wrestling arena or the Ogo village square. Young women in large numbers dance excitedly to cheer the winners. Drummers add color to the event, dishing out martial fight of war and pulsating high and low beats. Old men are not left out of the show. Though wrestling is equally recreational for them, the older folks have a role to play in decision making. They have the final say as to when a wrestling match ends. I bet. Sheesh. Now, the Nkwa Umu Akbangho is a dance. It's a natural way of expressing our physical emotions, and it has been like that since ages. From the time of the early men, Nkwa Umu Akpo, which means mating's dance, is one of the best cultural dance groups and a pride of all in Africa. It was founded in 1970 by Chief Vincent Omesi Nwachi from Ndebi, Afikpo, which is the Ebonyi state in Nigeria. He brought it to the national and international limelight. Now, the Mbe Festival is a feast and a song festival in Afikpo. Mbe in Igbo land means tortoise, and Ibu Mbe literally means tortoise song. Mbe Festival combines great music and dance with social satire. It uses humor or ridicule to expose and criticize people's vices in the society. The lyrics of the song criticizes individuals and groups who committed offenses or violated the community norms and rules. The reason for this is to name disgrace and put the evildoers to shame so as to serve as a lesson and note of warning two others. Now, Igihu Day is an annual celebration of Afikpo people, which is done on or about the month of June. It is a means of preserving the Afikpo cultural heritage and a day of displaying the rich culture of the Afikpo people in various forms. Many events take place that day, and a lot of people are attracted to grace the occasion. Among the attractions are dozens of masquerades, folklore reenactments of cultural norms and practices, and much more. Pottery, right? Afikpo pottery is the craft of making ceramic materials using mud. Potters dig up clay and additives from the ground, mixing required quantity of water. The clay mixture is modeled into the desired shape and form by using the hand of a jigger, using a tool that copies the form of a master model onto a production piece. The product will be dried in a mold or cut into slabs and subjected to a very high temperature, fired, to harden the piece to enable it to hold water. The methods for forming pottery depends on the artisan, the skilled craft workers who make things by hand, who create them. The potters make decorative potteries like dishes, plates, cups, cooking pots, storage jars, etc. In conclusion, the Afikpo people have been deemed the most harmless people among the Igbo and very easygoing. Culturally, like all Nigerians, they have similarities and differences. One will not find an overly large amount of scholarship on the Afikpo, by and large because West African countries in general are brushed over. However, we all can learn from the Afikpo. There go your sources. Let me get out of this screen. Yeah, man, I just wanted to drop that on y'all real quick. Something brief, something educational in regarding to the Afikpo. So I do want to say, man, I appreciate everyone tapping in, checking this out. Those of you who actually caught it late, I'm leaving this very digestible. It will be under 45 minutes. And I appreciate everybody's time. Look forward to more information coming from me in the direction of West Africa, critical thinking, evolution, Islam. Right now, the book can be pre-ordered right now. The release date is not until 5-6. I've sent out several copies to people already. Locally, I've dished out about 10 copies locally so far. Man, I sold a gang of the Islam books already. You know, and it's just pre-order phase, so it hasn't really been officially released. But everybody that I sold books to, they got their books in hand, signed copies, and it is what it is. I have to, I actually have to drop off two books to my partner today. So that's good stuff right there. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, it is what it is. But if you haven't got your copy of The Coming of Islam in Bilad of Sudan, I just dropped the link in the chat. The link is also in the description of this particular video. Please tap in, get with that information, and appreciate it. If you missed COVID presentation earlier, where he talked about where's the love in regards to his feelings and his perspective between two of his brothers that he has taken an issue with, and he expresses that in his bill. Make sure that you go over to Kofi Paisai Research Team YouTube channel and Kofi Paisai TV and check out that bill that he just did not too long ago, not even an hour ago old. So you can get his perspective, and you also can get the teaching moment within that he provides in his bill. And I think a lot of y'all could take the advice that he's given in that presentation as well, because a lot of people could actually grow, learn, and develop from that advice that he is providing. So, you know, For those of you that are looking for the shenanigans, you have to pay attention to what Kofi's saying in his particular video regarding his brothers who are at odds or disagreements, or if there, you know, is. But a lot of people really don't know the true emphasis of all of that. And as Kofi said, he didn't realize it until the other day, the severity of which. So you need to make sure that y'all check that out, tap into that, and ignore the noise. You know what I mean? Because my feelings ain't hurt. My feelings ain't hurt at all. You know what I'm saying? Like, y'all don't know what's going on, and that's fine. I haven't said anything because I feel like the person on the other side of that argument or disagreement respectfully hasn't acknowledged it, which is a big problem. And that has to, the acknowledgement and the accountability has to be taken up first before I even have any type of conversation. But, you know, as I said in the chat over there, I was expecting a phone call after a video that I did months ago was critiqued, was supposedly that he, you know, that person was supposedly going to watch and then hit me up and let me know their feelings. Instead, they didn't do that. They went live on their channel. So I took that as, you know, that was strike one. You know what I mean? Strike two was the commentary behind it and the antics. So, you know, that goes, that starts the back and forth. And I'm just giving y'all a little insight on the flip side. That starts the back and forth. And then there were some other things that transpired within that that none of y'all know. And y'all don't know. And I don't think he realized it. You know what I'm saying? Although I do think he realized it because of a conversation when a person came to me about what he was saying to them. And I don't drag people into anything that has to do with any ill wills that I have. I want to say that because I know Kofi tapped in. But that person on the other side of the argument was pulling people in from all directions. And therefore, you'll get people who have I've either had a disagreement with or just don't like me in general. You'll get them choosing sides and saying the things that they say. It's unfortunate, but that's how that goes. You feel me? When you're at odds with a person and you know these people don't like, I think that's intentional. But I don't want to, that's late, that's, you know, some recent stuff. That ain't really the issue that needs to be mentioned, or nor it won't be mentioned live or talked about live, but it'll be, whenever that time come, if a time come at all that I have a private conversation, it will come out in that conversation. But until the acknowledgement transpires, I don't see that conversation actually happen. So, you know, I don't have no problem taking accountability for my role in it. I know Kofi is upset at both of us, you know what I'm saying? Rightfully so. I don't want nobody picking and choosing those sides. That's why I ain't told nobody nothing. I ain't telling y'all to not go over there. I ain't telling y'all not to tap into that. I ain't saying none of that. My work is my work. I ain't been focused on it. You know what I'm saying? I feel bad, Kofi, that a brother hit you up in your inbox, though, and tried to instigate some type of conversation between me and you based on me critiquing their work. I was never disrespectful to that person, first of all. Once I felt disrespected by that person, then they turned me on to they going into their work and disseminating their work and then destroying their work. And, you know, it is what it is at that point. But my head ain't in no space to continue to talk about, you know what I'm saying, that other situation, though. I ain't even there. I feel good. I feel like I got my peace of mind back. I feel like I'm more focused on the work. I'm just worried about moving things forward and continue building and educating the community and making sure they're armed with the correct information at all times. I'm not saying I'm always right. I'm not going to do the things people like the most. I'm going to make everybody uncomfortable, because it's only when we get very uncomfortable that we actually learn. And I don't think people understand that. Like, I'm not for all these people following me. That's why I ain't on Twitter. That's why I ain't on Instagram. I don't have no personal Instagram page. You know what I'm saying? I'm not into that like that. Like my Facebook, the only social media that but outside of YouTube that I actually have, ain't nothing but it's all about information. If it ain't about information, it's about them dogs. If it ain't about them dogs, then it's about them books. What's about the products that we actually get. That's all I use social media for. I don't use it to advertise my personal life or my family, my kids, my situations, my frustrations. None of that. It ain't none of y'all goddamn business. You know what I'm saying? Ultimately, you know, I know how to let people see what they need to see, and that's it. Because that's all I feel like people need to see. You know, other people use their social medias to put their, you know, their loved ones and all of, that's how you use it. You know, I don't tell nobody how to use their thing, but and with all due respect, man, it is what it is with me on my side. It's how I rock. You know, I ain't got no problem with banging with nobody. You bring the smoke, I'm gonna stand up and I'm gonna take it. You got a real personal problem with me, I ain't hard to find. You know, I could be in Atlanta, I can be in LA, I can be in Brooklyn, I can be in Harlem, I can be in Charleston, you know what I'm saying? I can be in Indianapolis, I can be in Louisville, I can be in Lexington, I can be in Cincinnati, you know what I'm saying? I can be in wherever I need to be. I can be there. I don't back down from nothing, and you just cap on here. So all you little disrespectful people, I've been looking in the, you know what I'm saying? I read the little chat comments and all of that. I don't watch a lot of the videos no more. But when things was turned up and people was going back and forth, I was peeping at people talking about I switched up. Nah, I ain't switched. I'm the same person. I bring the smoke to everybody. I argue with everybody, my teachers, my friends, everybody. And if you knew me, then you would know better. Like, yo, this just Sean arguing. I'm gonna hash out the truth one way or another. If I feel some type of way about the information and something don't settle right on my stomach, I'm gonna attack it until it's settled. That's just the way it go. So don't feel special because I didn't beat up you. I mean, I'm going over your information or things like that. Nah, I do that with everybody. Don't feel special. So JJ, I know you was in the chat and all of that. Don't feel special. You felt like you didn't won debates and all these old other things. No, you ain't won anything. Because when you measure the information and you go back and see how you've been properly critiqued, you have so many holes in what you do that it's real easy to beat you up. But I don't brag about that because it's you. It's different. It's different. And absolutely, Kofi says something very magnificent. And this is why y'all need to go check the presentation out. We were told, you know, and I'll say this and then I'm going to leave that alone. But we were told that when a person gets to a point to where they start behaving a particular way and they become the smartest person in the room and or they begin to do naive things, that he needed to be checked on it, no matter what it was. So for anything that caused it, the instruction was already handed down and it was said to everybody. So people who got a problem with me, you need to have a problem with the person who told me that. Don't have no problem with me. Because if I feel like you off course, you off track, you off center, you not standing on principle no more, then I'm going to check you on the principle. It's just flat out just like that. So you want to get mad at me for doing what you asked me to do, then it is what it is. You just get mad at me. You just mad. You'll get over it. You mad right now, you'll get over it. No big deal. But the problem is when outside people instigate things and then they keep things up. Because a lot of people don't know what was said to us directly. So they behave in a manner as if they knew. And that's a problem. It's a big problem. Therefore, all of y'all got, you know, that try to involve themselves and try to send talk crazy to me when chats come up and then the live end, you want to throw your little Mr. Rich. You threw your little slick comments in there, bro. But do you really know me, fam? I'm the most loyal person ever, bro. I ride all the way to the wheels fall off. When it ain't no more tread, when we on the rims with no brakes,
We ain't got nowhere to go. We got to get out and run. I'm that type of person. See, for you to say I switch, nigga, no. I was going back and forth to Atlanta every weekend for like 8 weeks straight on my own dime. I wasn't getting nothing just for the teachings. Supporting, setting up, showing love, doing this, doing that, investing, all of that. Where was you at? What was a lot of y'all that got a lot to say about a situation that y'all don't know nothing about? Y'all went in Atlanta. Y'all went at these events. They was going around doing free lectures. Where was y'all at? All over Atlanta. Y'all weren't putting miles on y'all car like that. Y'all weren't getting plane tickets and stuff like that. Where was y'all at? But y'all got so much to say. Where was y'all at? Man, that man too old to be doing that, bro. He be out of breath. He barely can play basketball with his kids. But nah, man, in all fairness, maybe one day that conversation will be had. It's not like I told Kofi, it's just not right now for me. Because when I was in the mood to actually have a conversation, there was things that were said and then more information that I was being put up on and witnessing that turned me off from the conversation. So then I began to just sit back and fold my arms and see how things really was. So even in my instigations and talking crazy, because I will tell you right now, I did. I said everything that I said. When I said I made the man change his name, I didn't lie. I did. I pressed him on the name. He no longer stood by the name. Then I pressed him. On his own real black atheism. I did that. Y'all saw me when I did that. I pulled a book out, read the book in his own words, told him what everything was about. He didn't stand by it anymore. I did that. I said what I said about his business. I did, because the name of his business was Abjuwell. That was African, right? He wasn't no longer upholding to those things that he actually stood upon on principle. So I said what I said about that. But do you really think that I could take your business since that is your fakest, biggest straw? Some antagonism, you couldn't take that. It wasn't never about no Dogon or no. You trying to call me about aliens and all of that. I ain't want nothing about none of that. I ain't want to hear none of that. I just did a whole show with a doctor, bro. You ain't even called me and asked me about the show or none of that. You was trying to call and argue about some Dogon. I don't want to hear that shit. So, nah, I want about no information. But y'all don't need to know what it's about. See, I just need to do, I'm telling you, go watch Kofi's show. Yeah, that boy T. Now, this is funny right here. It's funny. But nah, man, it is what it is. You know what I'm saying? Like, everything else is cool. Everything else is cool. Everything else is what I expect. You know what I mean? I think somebody that spoke to both of us basically said it best and just told me what to do. Not really what to do, but like what to look out for. And they was right. You know what I'm saying? During times like what had happened a few weeks ago, a month ago, 2 months ago, or whatever, it show you who real, who fake. Cause I still ain't the same. I ain't lost no love for him. Kofi said he's still in my book. He in my book. Everybody that's seen his name in my book. Everybody know he in the book. I already told Kofi that I'm sending him a book, but I'm doing it on my terms. All of that. You know what I'm saying? Maybe he'll burn that book too. That'd be even better. You know what I'm saying? Since he burned one of his copies, he paid for what SARS-CoV-2 taught me. You know, he kept the other copies, but he burned one of the copies. You know what I'm saying? So maybe I send him this copy, he'd be like, F the book and burn that. We'll see where we really are. You know what I'm saying? So man, let me quit playing, man. So look. I appreciate everybody tapping in, man. You ain't gonna hear me talk about that no more. I'm a little bit past that. I'm about the information. I think the Afikpo people deserve their just due. There's more to be learned about these people than most people assume. I have books from West African history that talk specifically about West Africa, and the Afikpo people don't even show up in that. But the same, the Akan, the Yoruba, the Igbo, you know what I mean? The Hassa, the Fulani, like all of them who dominate, the Akan, all of those people, they dominate West African history that so much, you know what I mean, that we don't really get to get into the subgroups and the smaller ethnic groups in West Africa. And there's a lot of lessons that could be learned from those ethnic groups, those smaller ethnic groups, you know, because it ain't number 35,000 of them. You're talking about, you know what I mean? Well, the Yoruba, if you look among the Yoruba, look how big of a population they is, the Akan and so forth. So we just really got to get back into those subgroups and properly educate ourselves, because a lot of y'all that reacclimate themselves to Africa, a lot of y'all are those people. A lot of y'all are the Afikpo people. So I hope you learn something from the history, art, and culture of the Afikpo. And maybe it'll cause you to go digging into your, Google and doing some searches and extracting some of that information. Chavis, I don't know if you're still here, but you have to think about, you know, from the stuff that you're working on specifically, the Afikpo isn't too far away from those people that you're studying and researching, and you're getting ready to bring information out on that you're working on right now, because of that cross-cultural, cross-river connection. And those are significant entry pots. So, Teddy, I did see your comment in the chat, bro. I figured that you would. There's a lot of people who got the book a week ago, 2 weeks ago, that have told me they have already completed the book. And then I've gotten some feedback from them about the actual book. You know, of course, my brothers, Sutek and Chavis, they have completed the book. I've gotten some feedback from them. I'm more interested in the romanticists, how they feel about it, ultimately. You know what I mean? I want to see what the romanticists have to say, if they agree or disagree, or if they will learn something about themselves that they didn't know before, if they could remove the bias and do what I did, remove my biases, because it's difficult, but it can be done, and just try to learn from it. You know what I mean? And yeah, I mean, what Sutek just basically said, the way it's written, my intention, based on the way that is written, is for it to flow a particular way and build up to each chapter. So when you begin to read it, it's to build up for the next chapter, and then 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 it concludes itself. But that was the goal, is to write it in a writing style that will make it easy for you to read and continue to read. So, you know, it's easy on your eyes. I felt like I took the advice of what someone says. I believe it might have been Teddy, but it might have been some other people that's in the chat that ain't really said anything. I took your advice. Your advice was that you liked the font size and made it easier for you to read, and therefore made it easier for you to continue to keep reading. So, you know, I wanted to stick to a font size that would be good on our eyes, because we are getting older. But at the same time, you didn't have to strain, and then it'd be a problem, because most of the books that we read, you know, we have, they're real small fonts. You have like 11 or 10, 11 or 12 font size in a 6x9 book, and the whole page ain't got nothing but words on it. And those books tend to slow people down from actually reading and understanding all of those things. You know, and that be a problem within itself, as far as the way things go. Sutek said, we need to see you letting off the new Glock. Oh man, y'all don't need to see that, bro. Y'all don't need to see that. Y'all don't need to see that new Glock, bro. That thing be hawking. Yeah. And I got them hollows in that Joker too, man. The nice ones. They, you know, got the little black coated things on them. It's the word slipping my mind. But oh yeah, as far as target practice, yeah, hold on 1 second. I'll show y'all a couple of stuff real quick. All right, so what I would highly recommend for anybody, I'm not gonna show y'all my Glock. You know what I'm saying? And for the dude that told me to the disrespecting me on Garfield's show when he called in to say what he said, he gonna have to see me about what he said. A lot of people gonna have to see me about what they said. But you know, these shots, you know what I'm saying? I bought like 400 rounds of, I got away with buying 400 rounds of training ammunition. And in this picture, and you probably can't see it, right? You probably can't see it that good. But this was 100 shots into this thing right here. Now, if you look at this picture, bro, in all fairness, I was not off this picture or off this human size. As you can see, it said right there, life-size human silhouette. So if you can just only imagine, this is an actual human. I was off twice by the ear over here. I was off over here. You really can't see it, but I'm claiming that one. I was off right here. Everywhere else, I was all over the human body. You know what I'm saying? So I would say about 3 times I was outside the human body. And I can tell you why. When I went off here, that's when I went off here, I was squeezing the trigger too fast. And my trigger pull was an issue when I started wanting to squeeze too fast. And I just aimed up and just started. And I lost my grip and I felt it slip because my hand was sweating. It was hot as hell. And them two shots went right there. But after them two shots, I came up off the trigger, reset myself. And then I got to busting. But I got to get better though, because I ain't bullseye right there. Not to say I ain't trying to really aim at nobody top like that. But you know, you ain't gonna have no ass, nose, and yo, I'm gonna eat your face up. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of these shots were repeated shots. And that's why I said in this one, I shot it 100 times, but you don't see 100 holes. You see like 30, 35. But I was hitting some of these spots so many different times that it was crazy. And the dude who was watching me shoot, this older man, you know what I'm saying? He kept on giving me props. He was like, hey, man, you know, I know this is your first time over here at this thing shooting, but you're doing a real good job shooting. You know what I'm saying? Far better than a lot of people I've come in here, because he said he been saying people, if this was their target, they'd be all over here 10 times over here. And I got mad at myself about this shot, and this shot. And then these two shots over here, and then a shot that was right here off page when I was trying to see if I can make it more do what I wanted to do. But it is what it is. But I shot 100 times in this one, but this one's a smaller target. And yeah, you can see my face through this, but I shot 100 times through this, and my whole focus was just on the center mass. I ain't come off the page at all. As you can see, even got my name on there with 100. I ain't come off the page at all, but I tore
a large portion, and then I went high. This shot right here was my very first shot with the pistol in my hand. I mean, with that 9mm in my hand, not the 9 I got, but a different 9mm. It was a Glock 17. The 9 I got now is a Glock 45, generational 5. So anybody know anything about Glocks, you know GM5 is the latest Glock. But yeah, pretty much this was 100 shots too. But as you can see, let me be more specific. This 100 shots was it 100 shots? I'm lying. It's about 50 shots. It was 50 shots. This 50 shots, not 100. Some of these shots was 3 feet away, 5 feet away, 7 feet away. You know how they do when you go to the little training and all of that? This pretty much what that flow was. And a lot of these shots, you know, if you 7 feet away, hold up, 5 feet, no, hold up, 5 yards is like 15 feet. I'm saying it's wrong. 3 yards away, 5 yards away, 7 yards away. You know, if you ever been into those trainings or anything like that, they tell you that the fight is at least within a 6 feet range or less than 6 feet. So they always say gunfights are really like up close for a lot of people. For some people, it ain't. If you shooting with them, you know what I'm saying, with the machine. If you shooting somebody with an AR, or you got an AK or a Draco or something like that, you just trying to spray. But if you got a handgun, your fight is a lot closer than it is with a automatic rifle. But you know, I'm gonna be over there Joker tomorrow, man. Get some more work in, work on my headshot. You know what I'm saying? I'll let people know I ain't playing with them. Yeah, so you let your boy know, man. He keep on talking that talk. He gonna feel that Glock. He gonna feel that Glock. I ain't gonna say I'm gonna shoot him, but I ain't sure I'm gonna beat him in his mouth with it. You wanna be disrespectful? I'm gonna show you. But I ain't playing with nobody, man. I'm online, man. You know what I'm saying? Man? It is what it is. So Hornady home defense rounds. Oh, I ain't even got no more of them practice rounds in here, bro. I gotta go. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go get some ammo when they open up. Yeah, I think that's what I'm gonna do. I know I need to get some more shots out about twice a week or something like that. But yeah, they be pimping on the ammo, man. $20 for 100 shots. You know what I'm saying? And it just be the training ammo, brother. I know somebody got to have that training ammo for. Even though you can take a dude out, you can take a person out with the training ammo. But man, come on, man. They need to, you know what I mean? $10 for 100. You know, feel me? I sure. I need 1,000 rounds. And I ain't even shooting no assault rifle. But I am gonna get one though. I'm gonna get one that I really, really like. Sute got me wanting to go buy an FN. And I really wasn't even a fan of that gun. But he said he want FN outside. You know what I'm saying? He was just so hype about it. But nah, I mean, if you're not really into guns or anything like that, I think everybody need to have some type of self-defense class. And learn how to shoot an actual weapon to protect themselves and your family. Even if you're not in no beef or anything like that, that ain't the real reason that most people got guns. It's always about protecting their loved ones and their house, right? And not too much your personal things. You can get all of that back, but you want to make sure that you know how to do something, because if a time ever comes where we have to we're forced to have to migrate somewhere and survive in hostile situations,
that we would know how to conduct ourselves in a respectful manner to be able to survive those circumstances if they ever presented themselves to us as a people. And therefore, you know what I mean? We got to be able to defend our women and our children directly. And our women have to be ready to defend themselves and the children as well. So we need everybody to be able to get on that. Do you do any protection training with your oppressors? No, not with the oppressors, man. That's a good idea, but don't let me lie to you. Okay. There's some training that has been done with the oppressor canaries. And it's going to be a lot more. But Sandy, she's getting ready to come in the heat. And you know, they're gonna give you like 12 dogs. And they're gonna be made available for people to actually get those dogs. And our objective is to train those puppies. Like, you know, once we get through that phase, we train them up or whatever, because there's some big dogs and they're, you know, they can't handle their business and they pose a threat and they do protect their home. Like, they do not allow you to come near them. Like, they with all the smoke. So we're going to train those dogs. Now, what I've heard, Snotball, is that if we sell a trained Presa Canera attack dog, right, if we train those dogs, there's people that's paying $40,000, $50,000 for those trained dogs. So, you know, they'll probably be available at a good rate for a lot of people. But if we train them, then we're going for the gusto as far as what we can get, because they'll be trained. But it would probably be best if I did do some training where the weapon is drawn and then the vicinity. When I'm talking about me pulling my weapon and them responding to the threat as well. So I ain't gotta open your chest up with these hollows. Yeah, they are. Do you do any? Let me see. Yeah, they are. EIE. They are. Teddy said he liked the Glocks. Glock 17 is that classic. That's true. Yeah, it's been an ammo shortage for a while. And that's why the prices is up on a lot of that stuff. So when I was in there buying some ammo the other day, it was a dude in there with his I don't know what she is to a significant other. And what happened is, like, he went over there to grab a box of bullets and was, you know, going to take a shoot. And I think she got a 380 or whatever. She was looking at 9mm bullets, and he was like, nah, you got a 380. He said, this is what you need right here. He picked up the box and seen the price of the bullets on there and was like, we're going to have to come back and get these bullets because, you know what I'm saying, like, they charging too much right now. And it was funny to me that he said that. But I'm like, gas high? Of course the bullets going to be higher. So you really ain't got no choice. Yeah, it is. I'm catching up to what some of y'all saying in the chat. Snowball says, I find that people will test you quicker with a gun in your hand than with a trained dog. That's true. That's absolutely true. But man, you see the Presa Canera, bro, coming at you? Yeah. It's a wrap. That Glock 380 looks nice. Yeah, I'm not a 380 fan. When I was like in high school, my cousin had a 380. And we used to shoot that thing at stop signs and stuff like that out of ignorance. Like, we would be on the interstate and, you know what I'm saying, one of us would hop up out the sunroof and we'd just be driving down the interstate shooting at the signs. That's how stupid we was at the time. Like, for real, like, one day I was going to Clarksville. I was coming back from Nashville. I was going to Clarksville because I was staying in Clarksville at the time. And it's funny. We get off the expressway and we bust a left. I turn around and I start shooting.
stars shooting at this a holler. It was hollering up there at that nighttime because it was quiet. I just started busting at the little sign. And then the next day we go check the sign. Now see how many times I hit it. I hit it like 6 times. She said she won a SW1911. Oh shoot. She thinks she won a, come on, bro. A 1911 Smith & Wesson? Man, you tripping, bro. Ain't nobody getting them old school ass guns. You think you're on Magnum PI? The Beretta Woods came back in the 90s. Yep. People still talk about the Desert Eagles and stuff like that, but I think because switches are out now, people are really, 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 really back on Glocks because of the switches and stuff like that. Nah, I ain't got to Google it. I know what it is. Yeah, them 1911s are classic. Yes. Let me see. Okay. All right, I'm caught up. He said, there's an alternative to Glocks. Yeah, Desert Eagle is too much power for a handgun, bro. Yep. They got a little 38, a 38. I forget what 38 it is, but it got a big-ass kickback. That's a problem. But now, y'all really never hear us talking about guns like that, but we just been talking about guns a whole lot. So Tepper Rob, you know, he always down to talk about guns. That boy said, give me a musket with an infrared beam. Oh, man. Was your first handle? You handled that Joker? What about the new Sig Sawyer, the Army AR? So Sig Sawyer just released the AR for us to buy it. It's Army issue gun. They want $8,000 for this. I ain't no way in hell, bro. Let me show y'all this Sig Sawyer. Hold on. Then I'm gonna get off here. I need to tease some stuff. I need to read some more stuff. Sure. All right, so let me show y'all this, man. I'm talking about $8,000 for this gun, y'all. And it's hard. I ain't gonna lie to you. It's hard as hell. It's hard enough that made me think about it. This little rattlesnake right there, that ain't nothing but a little 3 bands. But this Army issue Sig Sawyer. I want this MPXK. I wanted that. My brother got one of them. Here you go right here. Look at that bad mofo. Look at that bad mofo. Come on, man. Come on, man. Come on, man. Man, let me try to find a video where dude's shooting that Joker, bro. $8,000. $8,000 for this. That's a bad mofo, bruh. Come on now, that's a bad mofo. Say it ain't so. Get your 100 rounds on one of them. That's a bad one right there, bruh. I ain't even lying to you. I am not going to lie to you. Take it off your shoulder for real. That'll take it off your shoulder for real, man. Let me see if I can find a video on YouTube. Hold up. Before I do that, let me do this. Can't nobody tell me that mug ain't hard, bro. I've been looking at that mug every day. I ain't even gonna lie to you. I've been looking for that Joker every day. I've been looking for that Joker every day, bro. Y'all can see the screen? Okay, yeah, y'all can see the screen.
Watch this.
Hey everyone, James Reese with Tia.
Let me rewind it back. Y'all see how big this dude is, right? Look how big, you know, he ain't no small cat. I don't like the way he holding it. You feel me? But he holding it how he want to hold it. But, you know, that just let me know that if you put, you know, the extra your accessory right there, the handle up there, that you'll be able to bust the way you want to. But look at him, watch. That mug pushing him back every time he rip. It's not a hella kickback, but it's kickback. Now, Sutek probably in the chat, and I can't see it right now, but Sutek probably in the chat arguing that the AR-15 that he was shooting got better, you know what I mean? It's better than this right here, because he ain't got that kickback like that. It feel like a handgun.
Hey everyone, James Reese with TFB TV at the Sig Sauer Academy. I'm with my good friend, Location, on the MCX Sphere. Can you tell everybody what your involvement was? Legacy systems as we possibly could. So we wanted to hand the soldier, we want to take his M4, and we wanted to give him a perfect candidate for the next gen rifle. Our intention was to keep the gun as close to legacy systems as we possibly could. So we wanted to hand the soldier, we want to take his M4, and we wanted to give him an M4, right? So that there was minimal training time, a lot of familiarity with weapon system, and they're really already emotionally connected. If you're an AR guy, you're emotionally connected to an AR. So sure, that's a good strategy right there. So we wanted to stay within the AR family. Hey, you're familiar with this weapon within 80 to 90% of its features and function, and it's just take it up and run with it, just a little bit of a training bump. So that was important to us. And then also, you know, the AR platform obviously is got a history in the US Army. It's a significant and wonderful design. So this is the MCX Spear. It's built and based off of our MCX line. Really, we kind of call it behind the scenes the big brother to our MCX Virtus. But it's a lot of, you know, similar design features, just expanded into an AR-10-ish platform size. We'll kind of go from back to front to kind of take a look at the features of the weapon system. Because of the MCX and its operating system, it allowed us to have, you know, like our MCX, we have a foldable, and then we have a collapsible buttstock, right? We improved the last design. So now it's, you know, not that it really needed to be improved, but we just wanted to make the ease and the ability for the average user just to not have to look at it and kind of bind it a little bit. It's intuitive now where it automatically pulls through. So detent, defeat the hinge, but when you collapse it, it's captured, right? So you don't have to worry about it flopping around. There's no button to put it back into action. You simply pull through and it's in action. The gun's completely 100% functional with the gun folded, and we've designed it as such that you have access to the controls. Very important to shorten the weapon system up for climbing, confined spaces, vehicles, et cetera, et cetera. So we're pretty happy with that feature. It's got a traditional and standard charging handle like you used to see on any AR, and then we've added a side charging handle. Now it's a non-reciprocating captured charging handle. One of the really neat things that we really pride ourselves in at SIG is our relationship with current and past end users. So we get a lot of end user and operator level feedback, and we translate that especially to our engineers, and we're very fluid within those design elements. So we have a non-reciprocating side charging handle, so it doesn't move back and forth while firing. There's no snag points. It actually has a detent and a nipple that keeps it from being able to be knocked out of battery. So in normal operation, you don't have to worry about it snagging on your equipment and being pulled out of battery and the weapon not being able to fire. You lift it up, pull it back. A pretty strong feature. We really like it. Allows a right-handed shooter to keep his hand on the gun and be able to operate the weapon system compared to having to fumble around a few ways that you have to with the AR. Notice that there's QD mounts forward and aft in multiple positions for left and right-handed shooters. You get into our controls. All our controls are ambidextrous, so three-position safety. Got the same features on ambidextrous safety. Our bolt catch, bolt release is ambidextrous. Our magazine release is ambidextrous as well. So all of our controls support left and right-hand firing. Look at some of the design features. You'll see that we have steel inserts here where the cam path would normally wear on an aluminum receiver. That never needs to be replaced. but it, you know, extends the life cycle of the weapon system. As we get in internal aspects, there's some other parts in there that are also heavy steel. So when we looked at some of the newer ammunitions that have steel tip or something like that, it prevents that from wear and tear on the weapon system itself. So we have a full length power rail for data and power transfer to our enablers, just like in our light or our LMG NGSWAR submission. M-lock forearm. Move forward, we got a two-position gas setting, normal and adverse. Suppressed or unsuppressed, it'll run in the normal setting. Adverse is for when the weapon, from maintenance reasons, environmental reasons, becomes sluggish or slow. Switch it over to adverse, increases the gas of the system, the system runs a little bit faster. But really, that's the MCX spear in a nutshell. I'd say one of the best things that we do at Sig Sauer, you know, I've got 22 years in the U.S. Army. Other guys on the team have 15, 25, 25 in this organization. We got LE. You know, experience throughout the organization. And so, you know, with all of that end user experience, we see what we thought were pitfalls and downfalls and improvements that would have been nice to have in the weapon system. But we also go back out to the military and law enforcement community. We put the gun out to them, and then we're very fluid and dynamic within the development of that.
At 50 cal in the
back. If you look at it, and that gun is available or will be available and is convertible to 7.62. And so right. Just think all of it as a 7.62 gun. That's
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like 300 Blackout and 5.56, where all you have to do, all the operating components are interchangeable between those two calibers. All you do is swap the barrel and boom, you're in business.
100%.
Okay. Same magazines too and everything.
Yep. So we're running, we run 20 and 25 round Lancers in that currently, but you know, Magpul magazines, any 7.62 magazine, you know, interfaces with it.
Why 6.8 by 51? Why?
That's well, you know, the thing is that was driven. The caliber-specific projectile 6.8 was driven by the military requirements. What you did behind it is a completely different story. So if you look at the other competitors and where we're at, you'll see a lot of variations in how they brought that 6.8 caliber projectile to market. It falls. You know, and then weapons are really built to those pressures because there's no reason to exceed them because the brass cartridge itself fails. You know, this gun is built to and test and improved to extreme pressures, and our ammunition is test and proof to extreme pressure. Be 100 on a very small level, you're 100 feet per second faster in a very safe zone for pressures. If you
this is how I'm gonna be on them pseudos, I'm gonna be ducked off just like it right there on them pseudos. Yeah, I hear y'all bumping y'all guns talking that madness, got running my name through the mud. Continue to bring up a little petty stuff, thinking that this really just really gonna affect me. It ain't gonna affect me, bro. I'm gonna keep on sniping your misinformation, your bad methodology, and your microwavable ability to not properly critically think and understand how to get to the actual truth of the subject matter. All you backsliding, shortcut taking to argue on YouTube. Be well. This me sitting in the cut with the Sig Sauer. I'm ripping everybody anew. I'm coming for your heads. So look, man, I don't want to continue to keep this conversation up or anything like that. You know what I'm saying? Maybe we come back later on, man, and we do the gun talk show. You know what I'm saying? And let people come on and, you know, get their information off. You know, this gun really just been made available for people, man. And this mug is getting hits left and right. Like, people want to get this gun. It's being made. I don't even know what this is about. They want to get the business. Yeah, shout out to Laura. She, Laura Try, she let us use a video to beat up JJ. Shout out to her. You know what I'm saying? She did a really good job making it across. She got a modified. I had the charging handle though. Do no target practice today, but I'm about to go on COD and let off all these same straps. Chihuda said, I never held a gun in my life. Love, peace, and hair grease. We all know you lying right there. Yeah, you have to edit this. Nah, I ain't gonna edit it. I mean, I can. You're right. Yeah, because we don't want an hour and a half now. But you're right. So yeah, man. Nah, I'm gonna leave this video like this. It's just two part. History of the effect, history and art and culture, and then you know what I'm saying, the shenanigans. But all right, man, I appreciate everybody tapping in, man. Catch the replay. It's a good build. Not a lot of dragging out. And we get to it. On that note, man, I thank everybody for tuning in. Spears are flying, pseudos are crying.